My second question to you, Dr. Farmer, is, in my experience, people sometimes don't want your help. Have there ever been times where a patient or a family did not want your help? What did you do?
Yeah. Well, you know, that's a terrific question. And I think that, and the short answer is yes, of course. But then coming to understand what was going on is a very, very important thing to do. And the, you know, I got to say that my lesson, the lesson that I learned in all the places I've worked, including Boston as a doctor, is that it's really almost never as simple as that, that someone doesn't want your help, or that a family doesn't want your help, a patient doesn't want your help. They have their reasons for framing rejection of help, by the way, which happens very, very rarely. But in those rare instances it occurs, the reasons are usually something worth knowing about. So let me give some specific examples, you know, from my own work. If I have patients who have, let's say, tuberculosis, who say, no, I don't want treatment, the more you look into it, the more you're likely to find out that they've already had several courses of treatment that have not been well designed or well conceived, or they've been ill-advised on what the right treatment is, or they've been denied the best treatment. It's usually almost something like that. And that's been the, you know, this whole area of what's called non-compliance. You know, people who don't comply with our expert advice. There are often reasons. And understanding those reasons, saying, okay, well, what can we do to make it more likely that our help will be helpful and our advice will be followed, if it's good advice?